Welcome to Attack of the Final Girls. I'm Teresa.
And I'm Juliet.
And we're doing something brand spanking new for our listeners. This is the very first episode of our hot takes.
Yeah. It's very hot. It's a take. I don't know. I can't be any more clever than that because my coffee has not kicked in yet.
My coffee just kicked in. I'm ready. I'm primed. I'm like, this is peak Teresa right here. But the hot takes are basically, Juliet and I are going to go see a new horror movie, one that we probably aren't going to be able to feature on the podcast because, listen, our backlog is like intense as it is.
We have a very intense spreadsheet.
It's intense. And also, like, some movies definitely deserve to be covered all the way, but some movies we're just not going to be able to get to.
Or we're not going to get to them right away. I mean, we do kind of, you know, we didn't have this when we first started the podcast, but we pretty quickly decided that we weren't going to do new movies unless they were available because we want to be accessible to as many listeners as possible. So we weren't going to do a full deep dive, like hour-long episode for something that, number one, we just saw in the theater because sometimes it's hard to take notes and remember things. But also, totally. Number two, that especially when we started the podcast a year ago, we were still very much in pandemic times, and we know that there are still many, many people, especially in the horror community, who can't or are choosing not to go to the theaters right now for their own safety or the safety of those around them, and are, you know, opting to stick with streaming and at-home viewing. So we're going to keep our regular episodes accessible to all by only featuring movies that are available in some kind of home media streaming DVD Blu-ray format. But hot takes for those of you who are moviegoers, and we might do some brand new streaming stuff too, we'll see. Mm-hmm. That's going to be kind of your first look at a new movie. And maybe that'll help you decide, even if you can't see it in the theater, it'll help you decide if it's something you want to prioritize when it comes out on streaming.
Totally. And these also will probably be a lot shorter than our regular episodes because, number one, this is a hot take. Hot takes typically don't last an hour. And number two, we don't want to spoil this for you. We want to try and be as spoiler-free as possible, entice you to go see it or to look out for it on streaming or physical media when it gets there. So these will be a little bit shorter. And this first one is available to all.
Yes, this first one is available to everybody. If you are a regular subscriber to the podcast, which I hope you are, you're seeing this in your regular feed. Moving forward, however, hot takes are a perk for our Patreon patrons. So you can subscribe at patreon.com/attackofthefinalgirls. We have super low monthly patron rates because, again, we're trying to be accessible to as many listeners as possible. Future hot takes will be appearing on the Patreon feed for our subscribers.
So for our very first hot take, last night we just saw The Menu, which you may have seen previews for at this point. It's a Searchlight Pictures feature. I don't think it opened wide.
Yeah, it's limited. Okay. Like our art house is getting it, actually. Okay. Our bigger theaters, one of them got it, and they tend to pick up some limited release horror. But I know that at least one, actually both of the art houses in our community either have them right now. I think they're both getting it, so they're getting it a little later.
Okay. But we saw The Menu, and it features Ralph Fiennes as Chef Slowick, Anna Taylor-Joy as Margot, Nicholas Holt as Tyler. That's basically your main cast of characters.
Yeah, we've got John Leguizamo in there as supporting cast. Judith Light, who I adore and love seeing her in movies and in stuff in general, as a old school soap opera fan when I was a kid.
Yeah, Judith Light, Janet McTeer, and I love Janet McTeer. If you haven't seen Ozark, she plays a pretty critical role in Ozark, which I loved. She was also in Jessica Jones for a hot minute, which I love Jessica Jones. Yeah. One of my favorite Netflix Marvel streaming TV shows, although they were all so freaking good. Oh, man, I really do miss that. I'm sad that we're never going to get like another season of Luke Cage or another season of, I mean, I guess we're going to get another season of Daredevil, but
be the Disney Plus version, so we'll see how that goes.
But never the Punisher, like,
Punisher's so complicated at this point.
Oh my god, I know. Ugh. I truly, really did like John Bernthal's version of the Punisher, but I feel like it's been co-opted.
Yeah,
and I beg every time I see a Blue Lives Matter Punisher sticker. I'm just going to say the quiet part out loud. Every time I see it, I'm like, please go back and rewatch that, because I don't think that it's saying what you think it's saying.
Exactly. Yeah.
Like the Punisher. Oh, I don't know. I don't know how I got off on the Punisher, but the Punisher is not,
he's not a bootlicker. Who you think he is.
He's not a bootlicker. How about that? It always like bugs me to see those stickers. And I'm always like, just take your stupid Jeep and go home. I don't know. Get a flat tire or something. I have such a hard time like wishing harm on people because I'm really superstitious about that. So I'm always just like, I hope that you get a flat tire.
Hope that you have a bad day.
I hope that your cat poops outside the letterbox. I mean, that would be a bad day though. So the menu is essentially the story of a young couple, Anna Taylor-Joy and Nick Holt, Margot and Tyler, who go on this very ritzy, very expensive trip to an island to eat at a very exclusive restaurant. The restaurant's called Hawthorne, and Ralph Fiennes is Chef Slowick, the executive chef at Hawthorne. And once they step foot off that boat, chaos ensues.
Yeah, yeah. This is one of these like very exclusive dining experiences that really does happen, where there are only 12 people that are attending this dinner and you are immersed. The meal has a story. The menu has a story. If you've seen the trailers, you know he says it like 6 times in the trailer and even more so in the movie. He's like, it's all about the menu. That's not according to the menu. We have to follow the menu. And that concept is a real fine dining concept, especially this sort of like, not traditional fine dining, but sort of the new wave of fine dining. That is a thing, menus that tell a story. And, you know, that can be a good thing. And that can be a very pretentious thing. And this movie kind of explores both aspects of it.
Yeah. When we first started the movie, I thought that it was pretentious to a laughable level.
Yeah.
Both the people attending this dinner, like the band, the motley band of characters, John Leguizamo as sort of a washed up, like former 80s character actor, and his attaché, you know, I guess, I think she's like an assistant or something.
Yeah.
And then you have the food critic, the very high elite food critic, Janet McTeer. You have the rich guy. You have the crypto bros.
Yep.
And then you have Tyler and Margot. And there's one other person, but I'm not even going to talk about that because that's like special.
Yeah.
There's one other person. You'll have to keep an eye out. They're there when you arrive at the restaurant. So just keep an eye out for that. But yeah, with the exception of Margot, literally everybody who is on this journey is pretentious to a absurd level. And I say absurd, but I mean like absurd because they do exist. And you know that those people exist.
Yeah, that's the interesting thing about this movie based on the trailer is I was thinking from the get, like, they're either going to do this really, really well. Like, this is either going to be, like, high horror satire or it's going to be really, really stupid. And I thought it achieved, like, high horror satire because the characters were so ridiculous and yet so believable because they're so ridiculous. You're just like, oh, yeah. Like, especially the food critic. I was like, I've read those reviews, you know. I've heard those people interviewed. I have heard, you know, especially on some of the podcasts that I listen to. Like, I have heard people talk about food using this language.
Yeah.
You know, where you're just like, what are you even saying at this point?
Right. And it's completely out of touch with 99.8% of people who are actually eating food.
Yeah.
Because the meals that Chef Slowick is featuring are things like, there's a fresh oyster that starts, you know, that's like how he welcomes them onto the boat. And then the amuse is like rocks, like arranged artfully.
With scallops.
With like a single scallop on top. And then your bread course is not bread.
Right.
And it's just like accompaniments for not bread. And the way that Janet McTeer's like critic character talks about it is infuriating.
Yeah, it really is.
Because you're like, this is not food at this point. This is teases of food. It's ridiculous. But in a way where you're like, yes, this is silly. And yes, these people are super goofy. Also, I would pay $1,200 to try this.
Dude, I know.
If I had it. If I had the money.
Yeah. So like, I thought the exact same thing. I was simultaneously like, this is such bullshit. And yet I was like, I mean, I get the concept of that scallop and I love scallops and I bet that would be really good.
Right? Like, it looks like the freshest scallop I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah. But also, I don't have $1,200 to spend on literally anything, so.
Juliet and I sometimes go out for dinner and, like, treat ourselves to nice dinner. And I was like, I could see this being a podcast, like, congratulatory dinner. And then afterwards being like, it was delicious. It was bullshit. It was delicious, yes, though.
It was delicious bullshit.
Yes, exactly. Like, we're never going to be able to do this ever again. It was horse shit. Also delicious.
Yeah.
But that was one of the things that I liked most about this movie is that it was extremely self-aware. And I say this as somebody who's watched every episode of Chef's Table. We'll watch every single episode of Chef's Table. It makes me drool to watch that. So, like, I will watch that forever. And I love seeing that. But also, they do a really good job of exploring the class politics around fine dining and how these foods are inaccessible in that state for almost every single person alive.
Exactly.
And yet these people are spending $1,200 a plate or a seat to eat this food. How appreciative are they? Can they be appreciative at that point? Can Janet McTeer's critic character get out of her own ass and be able to enjoy this food? Or is it beyond that?
And moreover, when you're looking at fine dining, this movie really hits on a question that I appreciate a lot, which is, on the one hand, we talk about fine dining the same way we talk about art, and yet we might treat an executive chef, and we very much see this in our lead character, we treat them like the artiste, and in this case, and this is very much the case in a lot of fine dining, it's the problematic male genius artiste who can get away with a lot of bad behavior because he's an air quotes genius white man. But also, it's just this really interesting push and pull. We talk about fine dining as if it is art, and yet dining and food in and of itself is still service, and it's service work. And so what is the physical, psychological, emotional toll on people who, especially like sous chefs, cooks, line cooks, all of the people that surround that head chef, what is that toll on them when they are supposed to execute art and yet are still treated like trash because they're in the service industry?
Yeah. And I would argue that while I do believe being an artist is absolutely a viable profession, I think that having formerly been married to somebody who was a chef in a kitchen full time, and my mom having been a chef in a kitchen full time, it is one of the most difficult and hardcore positions to have on your body on a regular basis.
Yeah.
Not only because, like, you can burn yourself, you can steam burn yourself, you're on your feet the whole time. And a lot of times in these executive kitchens and, like, fine dining establishments, there's no breaks.
Right.
Like, if you're on dinner service, you're there from 5 till 2 in the morning. And then it's like, okay, I guess you pass out. And if you haven't read it, or if you haven't, like, perused any of Anthony Bourdain's work, his first book, it's called Kitchen Confidential. Oh, yeah. That's what it's called. Yeah,
it's a great book.
If you haven't read that, I highly recommend doing that, because he gets into the seedy side of the service industry too, like how a lot of times there's a lot of drug use and drug abuse, but it's in service to the art.
Yeah.
Like, you have to do cocaine because you've been up for 12 hours prepping for the meal service and you had to, like, get really creative with some fish and, like, it's time and you're going to be on your feet this entire time. And, you know, I really would highly recommend that. It is so hard on your body.
Yeah.
It's so easy to burn out, because how can you devote yourself 12 hours a day to this service? Like, do you not get to have a life outside of that? Do you not get to have a family? So they definitely explore a lot of that. And I really, really, really appreciated that self-awareness.
Definitely.
Yeah. But speaking of service industry, you totally mentioned something to me earlier. Let's talk about sex work.
Yeah. So without giving too much away, this film does talk about sex work and talks about it in a really progressive way. I was so thrilled about this. Rare are the films that can talk about sex work in such a way where it is part of a character's identity, but it is not their entire identity. It is their profession.
Mm-hmm.
And it is not tropey and weird. They aren't like, you know, the person fallen from glory that has to be saved or...
Yeah.
Or and we don't know why this person is a sex worker, but we do know that they enjoy their work.
Yes.
That is a question that is asked in a conversation in the movie is, you know, there's this whole conversation about service from the head chef to the sex worker. And they're talking about the parallels of service. Mm. And the head chef says, like, you know, do you enjoy your work? Do you enjoy doing service work, being, you know, being good at it? And the person, the character who is a sex worker says, yes, yes, I do.
Yeah.
And it's never like, oh, I got into sex work because I had to save up money or blah, blah, blah.
My family member was sick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we can entirely imagine, you know, maybe this person just got into sex work because they wanted to.
Yeah.
Because that is the case for many people. And yes, there's privilege involved in that. And if you want to explore that, go listen to A Sex Worker's Guide to the Galaxy. It's an amazing podcast that really dives into that more completely. But I just loved it. Like, yeah. I love having a movie that is so much about work and service work and includes sex work in that in a very progressive way, in a way that doesn't trivialize the work, in a way that holds it up as this equally complicated thing to, you know, the artistry, the push and pull of the food world and the view of people that work in that world. Same thing with sex work.
Yeah. The service industry in general, I think we forget that sex work is a type of service. Mm-hmm. When it comes to the service industry, we typically think, okay, bartenders, folks who work in restaurants, things like that. But sex work is absolutely, it's the oldest service industry.
Yeah.
So to hear Chef Slowick say that and say, like, you are a service worker, you are one of us, was awesome.
Yeah.
And it's not a pretty woman situation.
No,
you know,
not
like,
at all.
This person doesn't have to be saved and, like, you know, go straight, quote unquote, and, like, get married or whatever. Like, it's just a thing. And it's revelatory in terms of the story, minorly.
Yeah.
It doesn't end up having to do with the entire arc, but it is a little bit revelatory because there's some interactions happening. You're like, what the hell's going on with that? It's because of that.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Not to spoil it too much, but yeah. The normalizing of sex work and adding value to that and being respectful of somebody who is a sex worker, it was almost a situation where the conversation, you could just, like, kind of gloss past it if you weren't paying close attention.
Yeah.
But if you're paying close attention, it's like, it makes it so much more important to hear that. Because they never come right out and say it.
Right.
They speak in metaphors, but it is clear what they're referencing.
It's very clear. Yeah. Yeah.
So I was extremely happy. Also, I just want to say, Ralph Fiennes could probably make a commercial better. You know?
Yeah, like, truly.
Like, he really is a very, very, very talented actor. And I think that, like, after having watched it, I think that if they had not cast him or not cast somebody of his caliber, I probably would not have enjoyed it. I probably wouldn't have been bought in.
So he, interestingly, I read this last night very late after we saw the movie. I guess that he was who they originally wanted and he almost couldn't do it because of schedules.
No.
And they wanted him so much and he liked the role so much that they figured out how to make it work. And same thing, awesome. I guess, with Anna Taylor-Joy. They almost lost her because of schedules because she's in, like, everything right now.
Yeah.
And Emma Stone was almost her replacement.
What?
Which is interesting.
I don't know.
It would have brought a very different nuance to that performance, I think.
I think so, too. I think I love Anna Taylor-Joy a lot, and I've seen her in quite a few things of late.
Yeah.
I think the first thing we ever saw her in was The Witch.
Yeah.
Which we saw together.
Yep.
Way back in 2016. But she was in The Queen's Gambit on Netflix. I don't know if you've watched that, but very, very, very good. The other folks, as much as I love them, are sort of incidental.
Yeah.
Ralph Fiennes is a commanding and, like, believable executive chef. It was very, very much a situation where I was like, yeah, I could see that. I could see him being, like, the power-driven eschew all other things, you know, like no wife, no kids,
yeah,
just food,
yeah,
or just taste. He says, don't eat, taste.
Yeah. And what I love about that character too is, you know, he is ultimately like, and I don't think this is a spoiler to say this because the trailer sets it up very clearly, he is the villain. And the film does a really nice job of bopping you back and forth between being like, well, you know, he's kind of have a point. And then like, oh, no, he's totally bananas. Okay. Yes. Okay, cool. You know, yep. And I like that in a villain. Like, that's very satisfying to have that kind of push and pull of like, I see where he's coming from on this, but whoa, he just went off the deep end again. You know, it was great. And I think he really brought the nuance to that performance to kind of keep you guessing with him.
Yeah, and I like that he is certainly not the only villain.
Exactly, yes.
Because another thing that the movie kind of explores as a concept is the villain or villains getting what's coming to them.
Uh-huh.
It was very satisfying.
Oh, yeah.
I thought. Now, if I were a person who could ever attend a dinner like this and be able to just like shell out $1,200 and be like, oh, I don't care, I'm just going to eat this for dinner. Which, to be clear, I don't think I could ever do.
Yes.
I don't think I could ever be like, yes, I will spend over $1,000 on one night worth of dinner. I don't think I could ever do that. But watching people who don't care about that level of money.
Yeah.
To have to reckon with their level of privilege.
Yeah.
Is very satisfying. And I will just say that seeing all of the villains have to reckon with their sins is very, very, very satisfying.
Yeah.
I think that was my favorite part about the movie.
Yeah. Somebody on Twitter, I can't remember who, or I would attribute this, so if it was you, sorry, I don't remember it was you. somebody who got to do an early screening of it said that this is the Midsummer of the food world.
Yes.
And I kind of went in wondering, like, what does that mean? And I was like, oh, yeah, I totally, literally and figuratively see what they were saying with that.
Yep. Yep, I see that now. Yep, it's clicking for me in a fantastic way, though.
Yeah, like, yeah.
Definitely awesome. But I don't have anything else. I will just finish up by saying that I really wanted a cheeseburger.
Oh my God, me too.
At the end of it.
Me too. It was so late when we got out and we're still in like weird pandemic times. And it makes me sad because I think the pandemic killed like late night eating experiences even further in our part of the Midwest. And I was like, I could literally go to a diner right now and have a cheeseburger after this movie. And alas, nothing was open at 1 a.m. on a Thursday.
Used to be that Steak and Shake, you could go, you know, Steak and Shake was open late. Diners. You could go to Waffle House, but also like, that's not the cheeseburger you want.
No.
And also if you go to Waffle House, like,
you're going to get waffles.
I'm not going to get a cheeseburger. Hash browns. I'm going to get an omelet, or I'm going to get a Texas steak, egg, and cheese melt. Always.
Yes.
I always get the Texas steak, egg, and cheese melt plate, hash browns, double hash browns. Put some ketchup on that shit. Now I'm just thinking, like, I have to go downstairs and prepare dinner, but also I definitely want some Waffle House.
Yeah, yeah. I need diner food stat.
Yeah, but you'll probably really want a big greasy cheeseburger after this. And not to say that you won't want an expensive meal, but you're going to want that cheeseburger more.
Definitely, yeah.
So this one is for free, but the next one.
Yeah, yeah. First one's free. Yeah, so this is our first hot take. Just a reminder, if you want more hot takes and other goodies, please join us over on Patreon. It's patreon.com/attackofthefinalgirls. There are several different patron subscription levels there that you can engage with us on, and we would love to see you there. Of course, we will always have our bi-weekly movie reviews in the regular feed, and stick with us on social media, wherever that might be: Instagram, TikTok, Mastodon, still Twitter in this moment as of this recording on November 18th at 7:30 in the evening. By the time this posts, who knows?
Yes. Sad times.
Sad times.
R.I.P. Twitter.
Yeah.
Thanks for listening to Attack of the Final Girls. Find us online at attackofthefinalgirls.com.
We are Attack of the Final Girls on Instagram and TikTok, and Final Girls Pod on Twitter.
Our theme music is by Houseghost and is available on Rad Girlfriend Records.
Be sure to subscribe on your favorite podcasting app so you don't miss an episode, and rate and review on Apple Podcasts so more people can find the show. I'm Juliet.
And I'm Teresa. Until next time, stay scary.